believe the NextEra and Hawaii Electric Company merger is a good thing for the state. But I also want to talk about maybe a personal opinion as to why I personally think partnering with NextEra is a good thing. And in order to do that, maybe I'll give you a little bit more background on maybe my work experience and my experience here in the Hawaii Electric Light Company. Sherry said, I graduated from Ohio, went to the University of Hawaii at Manoa, got my electrical engineering degree, and then was recruited by Lockheed Missiles in Space to go work on the Hubble Space Telescope project. And that was a really good experience to work on that. Got exposure beyond Hawaii, and that was a great opportunity. When we were close to launch Lockheed Missiles in Space and do, defense projects, I felt that I could add more value coming back home, so I didn't move on to the next project at Lockheed Missiles in Space. I came home. And when I came home, what I did, and the business that we talked about there, is I actually took my dad's TV sales and repair business over. He was retiring, and I took it over. I grew up with my dad repairing televisions and going around meeting with customers. And that's how I got my interest in electronics. That's how I got my electrical engineering degree. And at that time, before coming to Hawaii Electric Light, Hawaii Electric Light Company did have a lot of difficulties. That was, I joined in 1990. And back in 1990, we did not have enough generation to meet the peak. So there were often times where we did not have enough power in order to serve the customers. We actually had to resort to rolling blackout. And in addition to that, we needed to make a lot of modifications to our transmission distribution system. We had to do a lot of rebuilds. All of the equipment that we needed to monitor our system and protect the system if a tree branch fall across the line, those all have to be replaced. We did nearly 100% replacement of our protection, what we call a protective system, is all of that equipment. And at that time, we were ahead of the industry. We were adopting what we call microprocessor-based relaying in order to protect our system. It was far ahead of the industry at that time. And that was a necessity because on an island system, if you don't remove these problems quickly, you can have total system collapse. So, my early part, that's why I was hired on as an electrical engineer to come in and help resolve that problem. Coming from the mainland, working for Lockheed Missiles in Space, maybe I came in with a little bit of arrogance. I thought the utility business was not as complex as aerospace. And what I found, I really found that it was much more complex. You have all the elements, you have communications, we have our own microwave system, a fiber optic system, utility owned. We have the grid itself to meet. We have all the monitoring and control system. That was a complex system, and we over the years essentially did 100% replacement of all the devices. So going from having all of those problems, adding generation, rebuilding the system, changing out all the control and protection system over the years, we've significantly made improvements. But that's just to get us to where we are today. And over the years, instead of putting in fossil fuel generation, we've been doing a systematic replacement such that the new generation has been renewable, so that we've gone to a point where we're now 47% renewable. That's almost half of our resources from green resources. So I spent the last 25 years investing in improving the system. So that's kind of my background. I invested nearly half my life going from a system that didn't have enough generation, was very unstable, to a system that is much better. I don't think it's perfect. Our work is not done. Our mission is not complete. But we've brought it to a state that is much better. So I wanted to give you that background because now from this state, we have to take it on forward. We have much work to do. We don't have the technology, all of the technology in place, understood, in order to accomplish what we're saying we're setting out to do. So can you go to the next slide? So what I want to do is go over some of the things we're trying to accomplish regardless of whether the merger occurs or not. This is something where we're setting out about to do whether the merger occurs or not. So the first slide, we show our goals for 2030. So on a corporate level, after doing what we call the power supply improvement plans, we set the goal to be 65% renewable energy by year 2030. Actually planning to triple the amount of distributed solar corporate-wide across the three companies, Hawaiian Electric, Maui Electric, and Hawaii Electric Light Company here on Hawaii Island, and lower bills by 20%. On Hawaii Island, our improvement for up to the year 2030, when we run the projections and incorporate the plans we're looking at, we're looking at 92% renewable energy. We're currently at 47%, taking it almost, you know, beyond 92% renewable. Here on Hawaii Island, though, because we already have high penetrations of renewable resources in Manawa and Garawa, our projection for distributed solar is less. Instead of tripling, we're seeing it's a double. And then lowering bills is still 20%. Next slide, thank you. So here's a pictorial of what makes up the 47%. This is of 2014. So you can see a major part of that renewable energy component is geothermal. So we have the Kona Geothermal Ventures facility that we actually contract and purchase energy from. We do not own that. And then we also have wind facilities, one on the north part of the island, 10 megawatts, one on the south part of the island, 20 megawatts. That's the next largest component. And then we have small run-of-the-river hydroelectric facilities on the east side of the island. And then a component there you'll see is the customer-sited distributed generation. So that added up together comes out to 47% of renewable resources. Now, the goal, the ante has been up, right? The new goal now is 100% RPS by year 2045. And that's the recent bill signed into law by Governor Ige that now takes the renewable RPS percentage up to 100% by year 2045. And I think in the flyer, one of the questions was, is it realistic? Can we get there? Our projections, when we run, looking forward at our plans, we already said that 92% is achievable by year 2030. We believe 100% here on Hawaii Island is possible. Some of the things we're committing to, it does have an element of faith. Do we have all the technology in place today? Do we know exactly what we're gonna do today? No, we don't. I mean, we can't be that brash and bold. But we do have confidence that we can find new technologies, we can do new things, in order to get to this 2045 goal. Currently in our plans, to get to the 92%, we're looking at additional biomass facility, we're looking at additional geothermal, and then additional wind or solar combined with some kind of storage. Those are the large components of our plan going forward in order to get to the 92%. So we're using the word transformation to take the company, the facilities that we have today, and then move forward to a transformation effort. And those components are, you know, more distributed photovoltaics, like I spoke about earlier, a cleaner fuel. We're looking at, currently we use industrial fuel oil in our steam plants, we use diesel in our combustion turbine plants. We're looking at a strategy of bringing in liquid natural gas and using those and then getting off of the use of diesel or industrial fuel oil. So that's the cleaner fuel strategy. Greener power supply, I talk about some of the strategies, more wind, more possibly central station solar, more biomass, even maybe more hydroelectric. So that's greener power supply. Grid modernization. I talked about all the improvements that we made over the years. We have modernized our grid to the state that it is today. The grid is a complex entity. It's not simple, it's not antiquated as people perceive. It is up to date, but it's not enough in order to transform forward. Over the years, utilities have been able to manage the power system by just going to our hubs or substations. We've been able to manage voltage and current and service the customers without having to go all the way right up to the customer meter or actually right up to the customer's location and monitor and control. Going forward, if we want to move to the levels of renewable energy and to provide more flexible services to customers, we're going to have to move our capability. Instead of just going to the hubs, we're going to have to go to each individual customer so that we can share better information with the customer, we can understand to more refined detail what's happening out on the system, and also to do more controls. Because currently, we're not able to view the generation that's occurring out on the system. A lot of people are putting on their own photovoltaic systems that's essentially self-generating. And it's to the point where, in totality, when you add up all of the individual generators, photovoltaic systems, in totality, when you total them up, they're much more than our largest generator on the system. So they've even surpassed our largest generation, and they're out there generating electricity, but we don't have the ability to see what the output is and control the output. What we've done is we've gone to the hubs and we've put in systems so that we can estimate what the generation is. So it's not like we're flying completely blind. But we can monitor and we can estimate and get pretty close to see what the generation is up to the hubs. But that's not going to be good enough to get to the levels that we want in the future. So that's some of the things we need to do with grid modernization. And you know, some people will refer to that as smart grid. I like to tend to think that we do have a smart grid, we just have to make it a lot smarter. Customer-centric products and services. Starting in this industry, it was lights on, you know, proper voltage, get the lowest cost to the customers. It's just basic elements. Customers want more than that today. They want a lot more choice, flexibility. I think the issue with photovoltaic self-generation is they want that ability, they want that choice. And we need to acknowledge, recognize, and enhance that and give customer choices. I think that's the new movement, and we as a utility need to acknowledge that and supply that for our customers. And then there's associated with all of this market regulatory strategies that, you know, Mr. Curtis is an expert on, and you know, I'm not going to try and go head-to-head on those issues with him. Mine is electrical engineers. I rely on, you know, other people to do that component of the business. So, next slide, please. So going forward, you know, we're talking about tripling the amount of solar corporate wire. We're talking about doubling it here on Hawaii Island. We support it. You know, we're going to make it happen. But we want to balance that. We want to do that such that it's done fairly, so that one set of customers who self-generate do not pass on a burden to another set of customers. So we want to go forward and make sure that happens. And then when we go forward, I got 5 minutes. We want to make sure that it's safe and reliable. So now, go to the next slide, please. So we're entering this partnership with NextEra. Next slide, please. So maybe everyone doesn't fully understand what the merger is. We have Hawaiian Electric Industries, which is a holding company. They own Hawaiian Electric Company, who in turn owns Hawaii Electric Light and Maui Electric. And then Hawaii Electric Industries also owns a bank. So, and then you have NextEra that has also two components. It has Florida Pond Light, which is a regulated utility, investor-owned utility, just like ourselves, Hawaii Electric. And then you have NextEra Energy Resources, which is an independent, unregulated company that operates in an open market. The merger structure is such that the bank will be separated from Hawaiian Electric. The holding company, Hawaiian Electric Industries, will be dissolved. There will be no more. And then it will be just Hawaiian Electric, along with Hawaii Electric Light and Maui Electric, would then be merged with these two companies, Florida Power Light, NextEra, which has a holding company just like HEI about that. That's the concept. It's, you know, the NextEra is a large entity, much larger than we are. So earlier I said, you know, how, you know, gave my personal experience and how my personal opinion as to how they would help. I think we can garner a lot of assistance from a large successful entity like Florida Power and Light and NextEra Energy Services. Next slide, please. So Florida Power and Light is the utility that serves the largest amount of customers in Florida. I think the amount of customers they have 4.7 million compared to our 82,000 here on Hawaii Island. And what I see is they've been successful for many years, even before the merger, even before even conceiving this, even before encountering high penetration levels of renewables. We monitor Florida Power & Light, and they have been the leaders with respect to providing reliable service and low-cost service in the industry. So I've been, you know, reading a lot of trade magazines, seeing what they're doing and trying to mimic that. So when the announcement came that we were going to merge with them, I really felt good about it, that we can work with them to help our customers to a higher level of reliability and drive down the cost. That's what I personally felt. Next slide, please. They have the other component, which is an unregulated entity, and they focus on renewable resources, mainly wind farms and large central station photovoltaic developments. And they're the largest producers of renewable energy using those two technologies in North America. And I see that, you know, we have not built a wind farm or photovoltaic farm ourselves. And I think they can either assist us in formulating RFPs so that we can put it out, or they can even assist us through following the competitive bidding structure that the Public Utilities Commission has. They may even be a bidder themselves, but we need to follow that framework. But I think they can help us. This entity can also help us to put in resources and drive the price down here on Hawaii Island. So why would they come here? Rather, you know, what, you know, we're a small utility, why would they come here? I think they see what we're doing, they see what I'm against, and I see that they can look forward and say what's happening here is going to happen later on the U.S. mainland. And I think they perceive that they can learn from us, but they also can assist us. They can bring in technology, engineering resources. They can have help fund the capital improvement projects that we need to do. So partnering with them, they can learn from us. You know, we have very talented engineers here. I think we're very progressive. You know, our engineers go throughout the world to go speak at conferences. They are sought out from other places in the world to figure out how did we get to 47% renewables. You know, other people see what we're doing and they just can't believe that we've gone that far. So, you know, our engineers have spoken in Italy, they've spoken in Spain, they've spoken, you know, in Germany, throughout North America. They've been to Singapore, I've been to the Philippines. So I think that's what NextEra recognizes, that there's a lot of expertise, there's a lot of learning already done, and then we can partner and make this a much better and achieve the goals that we're setting out to. And I'll skip the last slide.
Well, we're at 20 minutes, I'll give you 5 more minutes, and then each of the other two get 25. Does that work for you? Take 4 more minutes.
Okay, so the goals I set out, you know, I laid out where we're going to do with or without them, I think it's going to be much better doing it with them. I've been here 25 years. It is a challenge. Many times we are in the forefront. You know, the kind of penetrations that we're doing with photovoltaic on distribution circuits is kind of unheard of. We're progressing out there. And I know that's a frustration to many customers because they want to do their own self-generation. But we engineers want to make sure that it's safe and reliable for our customers. So many of the times the delays in interconnecting distributed generation is for us to find technical solutions. I think partnering with them will help us to get to these technical solutions much sooner, much faster, and drive down costs a lot better than we can do ourselves. I think we can get there ourselves, but I think it's much better partnering with a company like NextEra. That's the way I see things. Okay, I'll.
Thank you, Jay Ignacio. Appreciate it. Let's give him a round of applause. You get 22 and a half minutes now. Don't abuse the privilege. Henry Curtis, and by the way, don't forget that we are going to have the opportunity to ask questions of these gentlemen, so be sure to write down your questions or have them in your mind. Henry Curtis has been executive director of the Oahu-based consumer advocacy group Life of the Land since 1995. He's been assisting with their mission of protecting the life of the land through sound energy and land use policies and promoting open government through research, education, advocacy, and litigation. Henry has a bachelor's in economics from Queens College, City University of New York. He's a community organizer and many other things. If you look at his bio, he's done about a million things. He has represented Life of the Land in over 30 regulatory proceedings before the Hawaii Public Utilities Commission. He served on the PUC's Reliability Standards Working Group and was on the Hawaiian Electric Integrated Resources Planning Advisory Group, appointed there by the PUC. And I do want to mention that for those of you who missed any of the presentation tonight, it will be on Aleo'o Hawaii TV. Scott Ordway back there is filming. We have Dave Corrigan with Big Island Video News. We have Carrie Marks with Occupy Hilo, and we have RJ Hampton back there, who's also filming, along with Sativa. So you can see this again. I'd like you to welcome now Henry Curtis.
Aloha. Mahalo for inviting me here. I want to start and thank you, Sherry, for moderating, facilitating. I want to start first because I wear many hats, and I was asked to come here representing Ililani Media. So I want to explain what the difference is between that and my other work. I advocate for a number of different organizations, but my media work, I try to be as neutral as possible while being as controversial as possible. To think outside the box, to bring together ideas from many different sectors. I've been blogging for close to a decade, and in September of 2013, I interviewed Lorraine Akiba, one of the three commissioners on the Public Utilities Commission. And I took that around to a couple places to ask them if they would publish it, and I was told no. So that's when I decided to do my Ililani Media full-time, daily basis, primarily on energy, primarily on state issues. And A lot of people commented, well, I can't figure out what your position is. The purpose of the media work was to get out ideas and not to take positions. So I interviewed Jose Dizon from Haniolo Power. Where are you? Over there. I've interviewed people inside Hawaiian Electric, and I've sought to expand knowledge. I think any conversation on energy has to start with Einstein. He said E equals mc squared, which said that energy and matter are the same thing. And neither can be created, neither can be destroyed. They can only change forms. So if everything in the universe is energy or matter, and mankind has been able to change matter into energy and energy into matter, if it always exists and it's never different, how can anything be renewable? How can you have renewable energy? In science, you can't. Only in politics can you have renewable energy. And if you go to Hawaii or Pennsylvania or Ohio or New York or the US or China or Hungary, they all know what renewable energy is, and they all think of something different. In fact, if you look just in Hawaii, in 2000, 2002, 2006, 2010, and 2015, we have five different definitions of renewable energy. And when we passed, when we signed the Hawaii Clean Energy Initiative, we had forgotten to define clean energy. So basically, it's a lot of different things. So rather than take a word like renewable energy or clean energy or sustainability or democracy, which are sort of very nice sounding words that mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people, we should focus on what the traits or characteristics that we're looking for are. Some people say what we need is low-cost electricity. And mind you, they mean low-cost electricity that you get into your wall socket, which is like 40 or 50 cents a kilowatt hour. Back 20 years ago, the flash bulb in your light camera cost $2,000 a kilowatt hour, but you still wanted to take pictures at night, so you were willing to pay more for different uses. Some people want low cost, some people want high reliability, some people want efficiency, some people want local jobs, some people want local union jobs, some people want economic diversity, some people want to promote indigenous companies or indigenous fuels. There are many different things that people strive for. And whether you go for HECO or whether you go for NextEra is dependent upon what traits you desire. And at Ililani Media, we seek not to tell you which way to go, but rather to say, these are the different options, these are the different issues, and you need to make up your own mind on that. Now, one of the interesting things that's going on right now is there are two major proceedings at the Public Utilities Commission. Two. They're the most complicated procedure they've ever done, and the second most complicated procedure they've ever done. And they're happening simultaneously. One of them is the merger proceeding. The other is figuring out how the heck you add on all this intermittent wind and intermittent solar and all this rooftop solar, and how you make it fair for people who have rooftop solar, and how you make it fair for people who want rooftop solar, and how you make it fair for people who don't want rooftop solar. So there's this open proceeding, and I mean it is complex because we're meeting 2 to 4 times a week, maybe 12, 15 parties. And the PUC has said, we have till the end of June to come up with a short-term strategy, and then we can spend a year and a half making sure we get it right for a long-term strategy. And so this distributed energy resource proceeding is saying it doesn't matter whether HECO stays independent or whether NextEra takes them over. Either way, we have to figure out how to increase the amount of renewable energy we have in this state. So One of the issues also that I find interesting is if you look at HELCO, and Jay said they're now at 47% renewable. You look at Florida Power and Light, and they're at 1% renewable. You look at this island, and 12% of all customers have rooftop solar. And you look at Florida Power and Light, and 0.07% have rooftop solar. You look at this state, which has great energy efficiency and is rapidly increasing it, and you look at Florida Power and Light, which has succeeded in getting their Public Service Commission to drastically cut the amount of energy efficiency that's needed, and you say, why would they be a good fit? What I've heard is they have money and they're bigger. Now, of course, Honolulu has more money than Hawaii County, and they're bigger. So maybe this county should merge with Honolulu. Just kidding. So bigger is not always the way to go. But on the other hand, that doesn't mean you shouldn't go that way. Florida Power and Light has a smart grid. We don't. Florida Power and Light has smart meters. We have a few pilot projects going on, we don't have them. Florida Power and Light knows how to get federal money. They are, in fact, have been rated as one of the top companies in the United States for minimizing their income taxes. They're paid less than 2% on taxes. Can you imagine if you each wanted to pay just 2% to the federal and state government? Whether you could get away with that? So they know how to get money. They have fantastic lobbyists. They pull in a lot. And they might be able to make things better here. The proceeding has, like, I don't know, 15, 20,000 pages of documents. And that's just the public version. We also have access to confidential and confidential and restricted, which is more restricted than confidential. In other words, some of the interveners are competitors to Hawaiian Electric, and therefore they're allowed to see certain documents under seal, but they're not allowed to see other documents. So where we are in the proceeding right now, there's about seven steps in. You can break down the PUC process into seven steps. The first step was called Project Oracle, which is when Florida Power and Light decided on their board that they were going to try to buy Hawaiian Electric. And then they met with Hawaiian Electric, and whether Hawaiian Electric accepted or rejected their initial bid, we can't say, because that's not public. But eventually, Hawaiian Electric and NextEra came to terms, and that was all under Project Oracle. That was Florida Power Light's code name for acquiring HECO. The second phase of the seven is when it was made public. And under federal law, there's like a 30 to 60 day cooling off period where all the documents have to be filed with the Securities and Exchange Commission, but no action can be taken, so people can begin reflecting on what's going on. The third phase is where the docket is opened and you have all the skirmishes on who can intervene. 29 parties filed to intervene. NextEra objected to 2/3 or 3/4 of them. The consumer advocate from the Department of Commerce and Consumer Affairs is not considered an intervener because they're automatically a party in every proceeding. One of the last parties to intervene was the Department of Defense, which actually missed the deadline to intervene by a month. And then said, whoops, can we come in? And the Public Utilities Commission said, you know, we have every right to just say no, but what the heck, come in. So we have 29 parties. And to be fair, it wasn't just DOD that missed. The Honolulu Board of Water Supply missed by one day. And so there were a few other things like that. Then you have skirmishes over protective orders, what it should look like, how a confidentiality agreement should look like, what the steps of the docket should look like. So that's all in phase three. And what was decided is what should be done up through the end of September. That is the first step. The Public Utilities Commission said, we're going to divide this into two phases. Phase one, we're going to publish and tell you what it is. Phase two, we don't know yet. So we're now the fourth step, which is that we get to ask all sorts of questions to HECO and to NextEra. We can ask them to HECO or to NextEra or to both. They have to answer them, and they have to answer within 2 weeks. But they're allowed to file all kinds of objections. And indeed, they file pages and pages of objections, preserving their right for a future legal battle, I suppose. So on July 20th, the 29 parties have to file their testimony and exhibits. Then NextEra and HECO get to fire off questions to us that we also have 2 weeks to get back to them on. The consumer advocate files their testimony on August 10th. Then HECO and NextEra file their rebuttal testimony on August 31st. At that point, the docket will be 20, 30, 40,000 pages long, and the PUC has said they will come out for public hearings. At that point, we enter, eventually, the Public Utilities Commission has to figure out how to hold a hearing on this among the parties. HECO, NECO, HELCO, NextEra, the consumer advocate, 29 parties, contest case proceeding, the right to cross-examine each other. At one time, the PUC thought they could restrict it to 2 weeks. Then they thought maybe 15 days made more sense. We suspected it would be more like 6 weeks, but it will be something like that. There'll be a hearing process. And originally, NextEra wanted the whole thing wrapped up by December. The PUC is saying, no, June is more like the target date, and that it has a reason for it. When the PUC makes their final ruling, they can go one of three ways. They can say no, yes, or conditionally yes. And if they go conditionally yes, NextEra can say yes, no, or why don't you reconsider? They can also appeal, and any one of the interveners and the consumer advocate also have the right to appeal. Now, the Supreme Court, is who would take on the case, has said that appeals from the PUC on policy, the Supreme Court will not overrule the PUC on policy, but they will overrule the PUC, or they can overrule the PUC on procedure. Has the PUC dotted all their I's? Have they crossed all their T's? And NextEra has appealed in other states, other jurisdictions. They have turned to the courts. And other companies involved in mergers do turn to the courts. Mergers across the country are phenomenal, with half of them failing. And those that succeed sometimes rupture. So it's an extremely complex issue, and right now NextEra is seeking to buy Hawaiian Electric $4.3 billion, while they're seeking to buy Encore Transmission in Texas for $18 billion. So we have a total free-for-all coming, and with that, Marco, carry it away. Take it away.
That was totally interesting. Thank you very much. Another option that we're looking at, or we're here to hear about tonight, is the concept of an energy cooperative. And this is not a new concept. There are more than 900 energy cooperatives across the country. So this is not something that is invented here, and in fact, there's one on Hawaii. Marco Mangelsdorf is with Provision Solar, which, interestingly, he purchased from Hawaiian Electric Industries in 2003. He's involved with the Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative, the chair, I believe. That's what it says in the bio I got.
I'm actually one of the directors and the secretary.
Okay, both of those. And actually, this energy cooperative, are you going to go over who's on your board?
Yes.
Okay, because he's got, there's some people from Hawaii Island, many people from Hawaii Island on this board, so this is not just a solo venture we have here. This group is proposing an entirely different model for our electric utility supply here on the island. Dr. Mangelsdorf received his PhD from the University of California, and he's been in the solar energy and renewable energy field since 1978. He also lectures at the UHELO, mostly in the political science department, I understand. So let us welcome Marco Mangelsdorf, and you have 22 minutes.
Thank you so much, Sherry, and it's really fantastic to see such a full house here, and it warms my heart that it's not just the three of us who are so interested in the energy future of our island and our state, but the number is growing and growing. It's also truly a sincere pleasure to share this space here with my friend Jay Ignacio, who I've known for a number of years and really do consider a friend. And Henry and I have been crossing paths as well for over 10 years, so it's great to be amongst friends. And I wanted to make one small correction to what Jay said regarding 47%. It's my understanding that if you look at the total number of kilowatt hours consumed on this island over the past 12 months or so, or let's say 2014, that number is actually probably over 50% in terms of renewable. Because as Jay was mentioning, these rooftop solar systems that many of us have, there's not an easy methodology to figure out exactly how much power they're making and how much power is being produced back or surplus back to the grid. So I really truly find it fantastic and exceptional that HELCO has done the job that they have over the years, and I've been a party, both a participant and observer here for the past 15 years, and they have truly been phenomenal in terms of what they've been able to do compared to virtually any other utility, not only in the state, but also in the country. So I mean that very, very sincerely. I wanted to give a few words of introduction about who I am, what I'm doing. My grandparents moved to the islands in the 1920s. My grandfather was actually a sugarcane geneticist. And while I wasn't born here, I've had Hawaii in my blood since I was very small. And I had a chance to move here 15 years ago to be a founding member of ProVision Technologies, now ProVision Solar. We were a wholly owned subsidiary of HEI. And it's been a truly extraordinary journey for me personally to have seen this incredible transformation to be part of a PV industry here, which came out of nowhere essentially, and was crawling along, literally crawling from 2000 to 2006, 2007, when solar PV really started to take off in this state and on this island in particular. So I can say with all sincerity that if we didn't have a cooperating, willing to work with us utility company, we wouldn't have the kind of progress that we do now. Now, of course, there's a ways to go. Nobody disputes that. The question is, how do we go in the direction we all, most of us seem to agree we want to go, and what's the best way to do that? So that's who I am, and again, it's a real pleasure to be here. So what in the world is this Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative? I got involved with this in December, January, and here we're June, and I had no inkling whatsoever, none whatsoever, that I would be sitting here talking to you this evening, 5 or 6 months ago. We sought to get a seat at the table in this docket, one of the most important, most complex dockets, like Henry alluded to, that the state PUC has ever seen, with a whole circus number of interveners. We got our seat at the table. We're now one of the interveners. And our stated goal is to explore the option of the possibility of an energy cooperative here on this island. So next slide, please. We have nine board members, four directors, and five advisory board members. You may recognize some of the people there. who I call my co-conspirator and the president of the HIEC, Richard Ha, who's been very much involved in agricultural and energy issues here in the island. He's a farmer these past decades. Michelle Galimba in the Kau area, Gerald DeMello, going clockwise, was working for UHH for many years. Noe Kalipi, my good friend, State Senator Russell Ruderman, Eric Weinert, also in the ag business, Wally Ishibashi, Donna Johnson, and myself. So we represent, I think, an interesting slices of the Big Island community. Next slide. We're an official 421C nonprofit cooperative association registered with the state of Hawaii, having been formed by community and business leaders on the island to, as I mentioned before, explore the possibility of promoting a comprehensive approach to develop an integrated renewable and sustainable energy strategy for the Big Island of Hawaii. Next slide. I love this slide, and I give my thanks to Jay for first exposing it to me. He's been very kind over the years when I've taught my politics of energy course at UH Hilo to give a presentation to my students. And this is one of the slides that he used a number of years ago. And I said, Jay, please give me this slide because it's so incredibly representative of how incredibly isolated our island chain is, which presents all sorts of challenges, not least of which both energy security and food security, because so much of both come from such an incredibly far, far distance. Next slide. And the energy game, as I call it, is very complicated, and there are many, many players who are playing this game in our state. Because, again, you can't maximize enough the impact that energy issues, energy prices have in our state, both for power generation and also for transportation. And I'll share with you, I went to one of my very first energy conferences back in 1980, December 1980, at the Sheraton, downtown Honolulu. And all the usual big shots back then were there. Senator Spark Matsunaga, if I'm not mistaken, it was Mayor Frank Fazi. I think the governor spoke there as well. And they were talking about the need to make Hawaii more energy independent, more energy secure, and we had all these incredible renewable resources, and that we could be a test bed and a showcase for doing all kinds of wonderful things. This was back in 1980. And I went to an energy conference a mile or so down the road in Waikiki this past December, 34 years later, and by golly, they're talking about the same thing. So it's a very hot topic, and it's a topic that we never seem to tire about talking about. So there are many, many players in this energy game, from agriculture to people who are paying utility bills and filling up their vehicles at the gas pump, to the electric utilities, the PUC, which is three members, Lorraine Akiba, Randy Awase, and Mike Champley. Many states, including California, will have five or more PUC commissioners. Ours has three. Elected officials, of course. Tourism and industry. We're still incredibly dependent on tourism and probably will be for decades to come. They're huge energy consumers, the tourist industry. Environmental concerns and, of course, energy providers. Who's actually providing this energy to us that we're using on a day-to-day basis? This gives also, I think, a very graphic indication of just how vulnerable we are, and starting with the pie chart on the right there, transportation. I mean, and unfortunately, there was an effort a number of years ago to try to boost ethanol production in the state in order to make us less dependent on imported fossil fuels, and all the best of intentions turned out to be a colossal failure, and that there is no local ethanol production of any sort really here in the state. So for all intents and purposes, when you look at transportation, we are essentially close to 100% dependent on imported fuels. And that is a really, really, really tough nut to crack. And in the 34 plus years I've been doing this here in the state, there's been very, very little progress. Whereas electricity, and I apologize for my data being a little bit outdated there, 2012, we have been making progress in terms of reducing fossil fuel consumption and burning for electricity production. But I think, if I'm not mistaken, statewide, what are we to? We're somewhere still 80-85% dependent, I believe, on imported energy for power generation.
Yes.
Less than that, 80?
No, not.
So the percent. What's that? But we're still. Okay, so 80+ percent still depend on imported fuels in order for power generation. So yes, we've made progress, but we have still have a ways to go. Next week. So what is this HIEC, and what in the world are we trying to do, and what are we trying not to do? I'll speak about both points. But just to give you an idea of what we think are some of the merits that are worth considering for a co-op of this kind is, first and foremost, and it makes for an incredible contrast if you look at the possibility of the island's utility, which is approximately 84,000 customers on this island of about 190,000+ people, the utility being essentially controlled by a company based in Juneau Beach, Florida, 4,800 and some odd miles away, versus the possibility of a electric utility that is locally, democratically controlled, and has control over one of the most important infrastructures on this island, which is the electric grid. Instead of having the priorities of shareholders and priorities of a corporation based very, very far away, a co-op would have the advantage of being community-based and community-chosen priorities under the direct control of a democratically elected board. And you don't have to go further than just a few hundred miles away from here to see a co-op in action that has been, by most accounts, quite successful since 2002, and that's the Kauai Island Utility Cooperative. So it's not just speaking in vague abstractions in terms of this is a really great thing, maybe, just maybe, we hope to be able to pull this off, kind of wishing upon a star, but I mean, there is a real world practical example of folks who have been able to make this successful, a successful model for the past 12, 13 years on Kauai. It's always kind of risky to get in the game of promising lower electric costs. NextEra is not promising lower electric costs. Anybody who is talking about a co-op cannot promise lower electric costs. But it is possible to make a case for the likelihood of lower electric costs under the possibility of either a big company with a lot of money, such as NextEra, or a co-op being able to get access to tax-exempt funding at a lower cost than what otherwise a for-profit company would have to be able to pay on the open market. So there is the possibility and the potential of lower electric costs through a co-op. And if you look again at the example of KIUC, they have made very steady progress over the years to lowering their costs. They used to be the highest in the state, even more so in the Big Island. They no longer have that mantle. Next slide, please. Greater overall energy independence. Again, this is not something that I think the co-op could, a co-op could essentially do dramatically better than what HELCO has already done, because again, I give a tremendous amount of credit to my HELCO friends for having come a long, long ways. And finally, the last bullet point there, I can see an opportunity to develop island-based fuels both for transportation and for power generation. I think this is an area which a co-op could be more nimble and more aggressive in pursuing. And again, one of the things that I learned as I was getting into this is that there is this incredible network of co-ops across the U.S. mainland, to the tune of over 900 of them. And they work in a very supportive fashion with each other. I was just overwhelmed in a very positive sense about how much support there is out there. And it's not just little co-ops here and there who are throwing pebbles at the Goliath of monster utility, investor-owned utility companies, but they are a viable alternative to both municipal utility and investor-owned utility. Next slide, please. So things got rather dramatic in December. HEI Chair Connie Lau actually spoke on that very morning of this energy conference I was in. I was attending in Honolulu on that day in December. Little did we in the room know that Connie was at a pressing engagement back in downtown Honolulu to announce the deal with her counterpart at NextEra Jim Robo. So it's I can remember sitting in the room on that morning and watching everybody just being glued to their smartphones and the buzz in the room as it hit the wires, essentially, that this was going down. And then the reason I put these photos here is because it's kind of easy to think of, in the abstract, you've got this big company, Hawaiian Electric Industries, and it is a big company. It's one of the largest, if not the largest company in the state of Hawaii in terms of market cap. And they've been around more in one form or another since the days of King David Kalakaua in 1891. But fundamentally, it's about people. It's about people. And I wanted to put some faces up there rather than, oh, there's HEI and there's NextEra. I mean, these are people who believe in what they're doing. And whereas one or more of us may not necessarily agree in what they're doing or want to go in the same direction, they're committed to what they want to do in their course of action. And I have the utmost respect for that, for Jay and his colleagues, Alan Oshima, a good, really great guy who's president of HECO, Sharon Suzuki, who's Jay's counterpart at Maui Electric, and then the three utility commissioners, Mike Champley, lives on Maui, Lorraine and Randy, who both live on Oahu. Next slide, please. So, what are some of the challenges to such a co-op? Because, I mean, believe me, folks, I'm not into just banging my head against the wall and taking on a Don Quixote-like life of tilting at windmills and, you know, mixing my metaphors with Cervantes. But, I mean, I really do see that this is a perhaps once-in-a-lifetime choice that we can perhaps make here on this island. It's not likely that you have another opportunity, we have another opportunity to go in one of two directions, one of them being HELCO, HECO, and MECO being merged, i.e. taken over by a much larger fish and a much larger company on the mainland, versus the possibility of direct ownership and control by the people who actually live here. But there are enormous challenges, not least of which HELCO is not for sale. That is a base reality. It's not for sale now, at least. The applicants, HEI and NextEra, have made abundantly clear that this is a package deal. And neither party can have any discussion whatsoever, formal or informal, with any other party that seeks to alter the deal. That's all in the 374-page merger agreement. I can't say I've read through line by line, but I've gone through it in some detail. So HELCO is not for sale. And I do not believe that it's possible in any way, shape, or form to try to force HELCO or HEI by beating them up to sell us the utility company, darn it. I mean, it's not going to happen that way, if it does happen. So that remains obviously a challenge. The electric grid is finite. There's only so much you can do with it. And again, HELCO, HECO, MECO have suffered plenty of slings and arrows over the years in terms of you guys need to do more. Why are you so obstructionist? You're anti-solar and all sorts of other wild and not so polite rhetoric. But the reality is the grid is finite. Today's grid, tomorrow's grid, next month's grid, next year's grid. You cannot have an infinite amount of power feeding into a finite grid. It doesn't work that way. So whether it's HELCO, whether it's NextEra, whether it's the co-op, there are still substantial challenges to get to where we want to go. So the question really is, what is the best mix of energy sources for a reliable grid, for a grid that's more renewable, and for electric prices, which we all want to come down. One of the big challenges in terms of bringing down the cost of electricity is that HELCO does not generate all its own power. It hasn't for many years. There are a number of independent power producers on this island who have entered into long-term contracts with HELCO. Some of them are advantageous for consumers. Others are not particularly advantageous for consumers. So that is a challenge because HELCO does not have complete control over the generation that is being pumped into their transmission and distribution system. And as much as people love in my business to talk about energy storage, batteries, it's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen next week, next month, probably not even next year. Energy storage is a huge part of the equation, but it's not going to happen soon enough, most likely. Next slide. So this is my last slide. What we're trying to do at this point, those of us in the Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative, is to get the word out there of who we are, what we're trying to do, education, encourage discussion, and what in the world is Jiminy Cricket doing on that slide? Well, I've always been a big fan of Disney, especially Jiminy Cricket, and one of the beautiful song of his wasn't Pinocchio, wasn't it? When you wish upon... Now, I won't sing any more beyond that. But, you know, it's a fantastic song, right? And to some extent, I feel kind of like Jiminy Cricket in terms of wishing upon a star because, you know, there's no guarantee about many things in life other than what was the death and taxes, right? But I see this as a worthwhile venture to stimulate discussion, to educate people. Again, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, perhaps, to make a substantial change or make a substantial choice between options before us. And it's going to be a very, very interesting next handful of months and next year in terms of how this this docket is going to play out. So it's been great being able to speak to you, and thank you very much.
If you have questions, write them, raise your hand, somebody will come pick them up. We've got questions. If I'm sure you all know that the restrooms are out there if you need to use the restrooms, and no food in here but water. And what I'm going to do is just ask the questions, and any of you are free to answer. Some of the questions I've already received are directed to one or the other of you, except that what we'd like is all of your input on this, because you're all pretty smart guys about this, and that's helpful. Questions coming to me? Henry, I think that you're best to start with this question because you all have talked about some really great options and alternatives here. But the bottom line is people do want lower electricity rates, and Marco said that it's really hard to promise that. I believe that one of the issues is the pricing model under which the Public Utilities Commission here and in most other places across the country operates. Is it possible, and how is it possible, to essentially change the pricing model so that rates can be lower in some way, whether it's HELCO, NextEra, or the Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative?
Well, that's a great question. When we embarked on renewable energy seriously through the Hawaii Clean Energy Initiative, few people read the document, and it said that rates have to go up as we begin putting in renewables. We've reached the point now where renewables are cheaper than fossil fuel. That was not the case when we started the Hawaii Clean Energy Initiative. So we had to rise up, and now we're finding renewables that are cheaper than what fossil fuels have. So we expect rates to go down. And HELCO, PICO, NECO, NextEra, HIEC have all feel that rates will probably go down, but nobody can promise it.
Either of the other two of you wish to weigh in, comment on that? Okay, don't have to. Jay, were you going to talk? If the green light is on, you can talk.
There we go. What Henry says is part of our core strategy is currently when we're dependent on fossil fuel, we have to generate using oil, and we're dependent on that fluctuation. We have to pay the price, the market price of oil. So one of our core strategies is to find energy sources, Henry doesn't like the word renewable, but energy sources, clean energy sources, that are lower cost and comparable in service to our customers. You know, just as reliable, just as safe, but at a lower cost using a different energy source, like wind, solar. But they're not equivalent to the sources that are currently supplying about 50% of the energy, at least on this island. So in order to make a photovoltaic facility equivalent to, say, a steam plant, you're going to have to combine that with another resource like a pump storage hydro or a battery. But when you do that, you can drive the economic skills up. You know, it's no longer viable. People just look at the one source. They look at photovoltaics and say it's much cheaper. But you can't just do that in order to go to the 100% mark. Going forward, you really have to look at everything. You may have to do more investment in infrastructure, and we have to run the economics to make sure that the combination of a wind farm and a pump storage hydro is actually lower, because the whole intent is to use different resources to drive the price down. Part of our commitment, we supported the bill, by the way, to go to 100%, but we put in the bill saying that we'll support it. We want to make sure that it's still just as safe and reliable for our customers, and it is economical. It's not renewables or clean energy at any cost. The economics is very important.
What are the electric rates on Kauai, Florida Power and Light, HELCO? What are the different electric rates to give us a sense as to where things stand?
Go ahead.
That's not directly comparable because, for example, Florida Power and Light is almost 70% gas and 25% nuclear. Now, if there was a nuclear accident, Florida Power and Light has a cap on how much money they have to pay out. So if there's a nuclear explosion at their power plant, all taxpayers throughout the U.S. pay some of it. So there are It's easier to make a comparison about how places move. So for example, Hawaii Island Utility Co-op, the rates are still high, but over the last several years, they've been able to reduce the rates. So you can see a specific utility and how the rates have moved within that utility. The problem with HECO, RICO, and HELCO is that they have very high amounts of petroleum, oil, and as we know, the volatility oil is great, and a large percentage of the bill is the oil price. So as oil goes up and down, it makes the prices go up and down. Now, NextEra says that their solution is natural gas, which has all sorts of greenhouse gas emission issues and all sorts of climate change impacts, but they've been able to remove the climate impacts from their calculations. So it's like comparing apples and oranges.
On the issue of natural gas, how does that fit into any of your future plans?
For the Hawaiian electric companies, one of the slides I talked to, using a cleaner fuel, it's also a lower cost fuel. We are pursuing obtaining liquid natural gas, which is natural gas that you compress into a liquid form, and then you're able to transport it across the 2,500 miles to Hawaii, and use it here instead of the diesel or industrial fuel that we use. Mr. Curtis talked about it, you know, being some of the greenhouse gas issues. We see it as we're using diesel, we're using industrial fuel oil. Liquid natural gas is not perfect, it's not the ideal solution, but it's better than what we're doing today. So it's not perfect, but it's making it better. And we're talking about using liquid natural gas as a transition, because in order to get to the 100% mark, you can't be on liquid natural gas, because then you're not going to meet the 100% mark. So we still see it as making sense to bring in liquid natural gas, pursue in parallel all of the other clean energy options, and then when we have those options at a lower cost, then we can switch out off of liquid natural gas. Now that's a complex process. There's a lot of economic evaluations, making sure that it's worthwhile getting liquid natural gas on a transition basis, but we still see the numbers. Even at low fuel prices, we see the numbers probably working out. So we're continuing to pursue it.
Is liquid natural gas a big part of NextEra's decision to purchase Hawaiian Electric Industries? If you were not going to use liquid natural gas, would that affect their desire to buy you?
NextEra has experience in the use of natural gas. They do not use liquid natural gas because they do not have a need to compress the gas and then transport it. They actually transport natural gas via pipelines. They have stated that they support our plants. So in that respect, our plans is supported by them, which is our plans is to convert to liquid natural gas. So in that effect, they support our plants.
Marco, you stated, and well, it's been very publicly stated, that Hawaiian Electric Industries does not intend to allow HELCO to depart, and NextEra has said they only want HEI if HELCO is part of the deal. But clearly your proposal is to take over, I believe, the electricity company here on this island. So what's the plan to get around the fact that they don't want to give it up? And actually, somebody also asked a question, given that you even stated that yourself, is this just a tool for further discussion, or is this a serious proposal?
That's a great question. I think we've been very consistent since we first filed to become an intervener on this docket back in February. Over the past several months now, very consistent in our message, which is to explore the possibility of the merits and benefits of an energy co-op here on this island, and to first see internally amongst ourselves at HIEC whether a truly compelling case can be made to move forward, or to try to move forward with this as a possible option. As Henry mentioned, you know, we're still fairly early in the game regarding the docket and the whole process of the PUC, and I would be willing to wager a substantial amount of money that the likelihood of the Public Utilities Commissioners voting a straight yes with no modifications and stipulations, I think, is extremely unlikely. So that being, if you take that assumption, if you agree with my assumption, then the other two options are they nix the deal or they approve it with stipulations. So we're still very early in the game, and I would not venture to put odds on our likelihood of success, but I would not be doing what I'm doing and putting time and effort into it if I thought it was a complete fantasy. Ain't never going to happen. Like you use the stars to guide your path across the ocean, knowing full well you'll never get there. I see it not quite as foolhardy as that.
And there needs to be a point made on this. In most states, only one utility can operate in a given place. Hawaii does not have that distinction. You can have multiple electric utilities serving the same geographical area. Parker Ranch brought in some of the national experts that Hawaiian Electric uses. They figured out that if they put in their own system and HELCO gave them the lines, they could save their ratepayers money. But if they had to build their own lines, they could still beat the HELCO price. So it could be that HIEC makes a move on HELCO. Jay says, no, we want to go with NextEra. HIEC builds their own generators and some lines. Then HELCO starts seeing a reduced pie, and whoever owns it, whether it's HECO or NextEra, says, we're getting gobbled up by this young upstart organization that is undercutting our prices. We better give them the rest of the system before it's worthless.
Marco, how would Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative be financed?
As far as how would we pull off this incredible fantasy that we're pursuing something along those lines, Karen?
Yeah, if we're going to get the money, you know, roll the bank or what exactly?
Well, I didn't bring my checkbook.
Darn.
To write Jay a check. But there is money out there. There are organizations out there that are very supportive of endeavors like this. And over the past several months, I've really had a very rapid education on what co-ops, the history of co-ops, and the fact that going back to the Rural Electrification Act of the 1930s, where you had the beginning of substantial electrification across the country, that was initially much focused on the cities, because that's where it was easier to sell substantial amount of power to a large number of people. But when you have rural areas, in which of course much of the mainland U.S. was back then, still is to some extent, it made a lot less sense financially for these utility companies to spend the money to build the infrastructure to supply power hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles across the plain states, for example, when there weren't that many consumers of the power. So this was a way that co-ops came into being and got involved, where utility companies, investor-owned utility companies, did not want to get involved, and in fact were fairly hostile for decades against these co-ops. Even though the IOUs, investor-owned utilities, weren't particularly interested in getting involved in doing infrastructure and selling to farms and rural areas. So to circle back to your question, Sherry, for decades, there have been financing means and substantial costs of money by these co-ops banding together and becoming more than just Lilliputians, pulling at the Goliaths, the Gullivers of the much larger utility companies. So there is, I don't want to tip my hand too much, but I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't have a degree of confidence that there is financing out there for doing something like this.
Any other comments, Henry or Jay?
KIUC borrowed virtually all the money they needed from basically two sources, U.S. Department of Ag, Rural Utility Service, and NRECA, the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association.
Hawaii has a higher population density per square mile than do we. We have about 46 people per square mile. Hawaii has around 108 people. So could a Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative leverage enough to make this a financially viable deal, given that we are so spread out, we're so big, and it's a tough island on which to work? Big island, small population.
Well, I've learned in listening to Jay over the years just how challenging it is for a utility company that has relative low density in terms of population, but has an infrastructure, transmission distribution, which is far beyond what the folks on Oahu have to deal with. So there's, I think you probably agree with me, Jay, there's kind of an intrinsic challenge that we have in terms of a limited number of customers and yet a substantial infrastructure that has to be maintained and modernized, kept up, and so forth. So that's going to continue to be a challenge. Whoever is running the grid here, whoever is owning the grid, that will continue to be a challenge. But by working with fellow sister brother cooperatives, there are various economies of scale that can be achieved, which can have a positive impact in terms of bringing down operating costs and therefore would lead to the potential of lower electric rates.
If Hawaii Island Energy Cooperative were to become a reality and we had a huge disaster, another earthquake, lava, hurricane, and the recent hurricane, Hawaiian Electric Company brought trucks and people over from other islands. If we were to have such a disaster and we had an energy co-op, how would you pull off the necessary things to get this island back in service, financially, people, etc.? What are you thinking?
I remember seeing KIUC trucks, right, Jake? KIUC sent infrastructure, sent people, sent vehicles here to help out during that time, right?
No, actually, they sent one person to observe. When the hurricane struck, we do have a relationship with KIUC. I've been in this, like I said, in this business 25 years. You can't help but build relationships and personal relationships. So Mike Imani, I reached out to Mike Imani to come over. Mike Imani had actually gone to Hurricane Iniki. I said, you have experience at Hurricane Iniki. Why don't you come over and observe how we're responding and, you know, let's talk stories, see if there's any way we can improve. And Mike did come down, you know, he came for a couple of days and he said, you know, you guys are doing just great, maybe even better than what we did in Iniki. So, but we didn't ask for their support. We got from Hawaiian Electric, we got from many contractors that were already working on the island, in Maui Electric. We did consider bringing in resources from the mainland, but by that time the response was going well. We were on track in order to get the customers. We got customers, nearly all the customers back within 3 weeks. I would like to point out that, you know, Florida Power and Light is in a service territory that had many hurricanes. So over the years, they've developed a very good emergency response program. And you know, we have David Spooner in the back here. David Spooner is our West Hawaii superintendent. He's in charge of managing all of the power lines underground overhead here in the West Hawaii district. David worked in North Carolina, so he recalls actually having assistance from Florida Power and Light, because, you know, utilities will band together in an emergency and help each other out. So if they've gone through a hurricane and didn't have an impact, then their workforce will actually mobilize and go assist adjacent utilities. I mean, we help each other in the industry.
So basically you're saying that if we have a problem and we have the energy cooperative, Hawaiian Electric Company or whatever it would be called at that time would assist the Big Island, even if you weren't the power company anymore.
Yes, but these services are not done for free.
I know that. Yes.
But I know the culture of our corporation. I know the people, and I would say they would come. I mean, I would even think, say, the corporation wouldn't support it. I know some of our employees would probably take time off and volunteer, because that's in the utility person's culture, to serve the customers and help out the community. It's just ingrained. You get into the utility, that's the life. I just want to point out, like, we have here Mr. Medeiros, you know, Danny Medeiros. Danny Medeiros had David Spooner's position here. He had it for many years. He served West Hawaii for many years. He's still interested in energy issues and he cares about the community. It's just inbred in the utility employee.
I would say that when the hurricane hit New Orleans, people from Hawaii went there and helped out. People pull together when there's a problem. And if a major hurricane hits Hawaii, you would want our food and our energy to be produced here instead of waiting on the boat trying to figure out how to dock with the harbor.
Henry, you have been outspoken in saying that NextEra is not the right solution for Hawaii. Tell us why.
I think there are several reasons why it could be the right utility. Because again, our role is to stimulate conversation. The Hawaiian Electric, over the last couple of years, has run into a roadblock of trying to figure out how to increase the amount of renewable energy on the grid. In September of, I guess it was 2013, it was a major, they sent a major shockwave through the solar industry by saying, we're going to kibosh more rooftop solar. They again did the same thing in January and February of this year, sending out letters saying, we're going to put a limit on how many rooftop solars can come in, and there's a March deadline. And lo and behold, the utility learned something. They said there was this March deadline, and then they got a tenfold increase in applications racing to beat the deadline. So HELCO, HECO, and MECO are all struggling, trying to figure out how to add more. And there are, we're in a position right now that nobody else has worked on around the country. If you look at Maui, for example, they have enough solar and wind on the grid, intermittent variable energy, that can meet their entire minimum load on the island, and is half to two-thirds of their peak load. So how do you handle all of this? No other state has achieved this. We have isolated island grids, and we are wrestling with the issue. The utility has not figured it out. The PUC is wrestling with how to do it, and maybe there are companies on the mainland who will be willing to put in the effort. Taiwan is in Maui, South Korea is in Maui. Different companies, different places are looking at alternatives. So we can't simply rule them out. We have to consider all options. They may be the way, they may not be the way. It may be that on one aspect, if you think cost is one way to go, or you think reliability is another way to go, that you may pick one and somebody else may pick another. Right now, we have in front of the Public Utilities Commission the greatest chance for change, and we all must participate. We all must get our manaha out there.
Thanks for recognizing the challenges and where we are here in the state. There are no solutions that we can turn to and say, oh, we'll just copy this, implement it here, and we'll be successful. We are frontiers. We are leading the way. And, you know, earlier we're talking about, well, what's the probability of success? You know, it's not guaranteed success, but what's the probability of success? I've been doing, you know, I'm born and raised on this island. I have a connection. I have a stake in this. And I'm going to tell you personally, I see the probability of succeeding is much greater if we partner with an entity like NextEra. Now there's, you know, everyone's concerned about that, but looking at all things considered, I feel that partnering with an entity like NextEra is going to increase the probability of getting there. That's the way I feel.
You know, we all want lower utility rates, and Henry has spoken of the fact that the Public Utilities Commission is struggling and will be struggling with how to come up with a model that makes that possible. With a publicly owned utility, such as Hawaiian Electric is, such as NextEra is, they need to have money for their shareholders. I mean, they are shareholder-driven. Their goal is to have the highest possible return. So how does that lead to an incentive for lower rates?
We're an investor-owned utility, so investors actually, you know, own the utility. They make an investment. And then in return, we, as a regulated utility, we don't maximize the returns, but we actually try to provide a reasonable rate of return that is approved by the Public Utilities Commission. We are regulated, so there's parameters. It's not just about making money. And I told you earlier, it's kind of ingrained in the utility culture. I mean, we truly take our duty to serve customers to heart. I mean, that, you don't get around that. We may not always succeed, Right? I'm glad Marco brought up, there's unique challenges on this island. To be close and equivalent to KIUC with the kind of service territory that we have to serve on this island, I think is remarkable. And I see some of our employees here. And I see Chris Holk, who is our partner. She's a leader for the IBEW, you know. They're remarkable people. It's kind of ingrained in them. So, you know, it's not just about maximizing profits and forget about our customers. We continue to have to balance what is right for our customers, what is right for the community, right? And then we do have an obligation to the ownership, the shareholders. And it's a balancing. It's not only take care of the ownership, it's taking care of the customers as well. And then I forgot to mention in that balancing, you also have to look at the employees. You do have to care for the employees and take care of the employees, because those are the employees that make it happen. They make it happen. They serve the customers and they serve the shareholders and they take care of the community.
I need to make one statement about shareholders. From what I understand from attending annual meetings with the utility, about 55% of the stock in HEI is owned by smaller entities, people, condo associations, whatever, and 45% is institutional. Most utilities have far greater institutional ownership and therefore are far more focused on what the mutual funds and the large money people want out of the utility. NextEra has a much higher institutional ownership. HEI has a much higher individual ownership among shareholders.
Henry, you spoke of the need for people to get involved. If people want to make their wishes known, if they can sort through this all enough to really form an opinion, how do they let the Public Utilities Commission know what they would like?
Thank you. That's a very good question. There are three fundamentally different ways. First, right now, 29 interveners are asking a zillion questions of HECO and NextEra. And if you have a burning desire to learn something about it, you could approach one of the 29 interveners and say, would it be great to ask this question? And that way, you'd get the answer. If the intervener went along, you could figure out an answer directly from HECO and NextEra. So that's one approach. A second approach is that the Public Utilities Commission will hold hearings this fall. Now, it remains a mystery how this is all going to happen, because the 29 interveners all have legal rights as parties. And after we file testimony, the idea that the Public Utilities Commission would then go out to the community and say, well, what do you think? It sets up a weird dynamic. So it's more like they want to get a flavor from what the community as a whole feels and not what individual feels. So if hundreds of people testify one way, that may sway them. But if one single individual gives one compelling testimony, that's not going to be able to carry more weight than an intervener. So they want to get a flavor of how the community as a whole feels. And therefore, the more people that testify, the more people that speak out, that's a second way. A third way is to do letters to the editor, to talk in community associations, to raise the issue, to get a feeling for how people feel in smaller groups. Many people don't want to involve, stand up and testify. But they feel more comfortable in small groups talking. So that's a third way. There are many, many different ways, but the most important thing to recognize is this may be one of the most important things that happens in our lifetime here. And you can be speaking up in some fashion, whatever you're comfortable with, or you can grumble later that you could have but chose not to.
Henry, what do you see as the ideal solution?
The ideal solution, and something we've advocated actively, is for as many groups and as many individuals as possible to get involved in this issue. The idea that energy companies and the unions, the utilities and the co-ops, we even have a water utility and a gas utility in the proceeding. The idea that we have two counties involved, that's fantastic. One of the issues that we've always found bizarre is that Kauai County is active in KIUC issues. Maui County and Hawaii County are active generally, but the city and county of Honolulu rarely gets involved in any energy issue. We've always felt that the more players at the table, the better. And one idea is that one approach is to get many people to present many different solutions. Because if you get many different solutions onto the table, one of them is bound to be close to what's going to happen. But if you have only one or two players talking, you're bound to miss what's going on.
Henry, you've been involved in this game for many, many years. What is your ideal solution? What is your vision for the ideal solution for our power needs, particularly here on Hawaii Island? Is it NextEra? Is it some company other than NextEra? Is it the Hawaii Island Energy Co-op?
I think the ideal solution is something that New York is looking at right now. After the hurricane hit, and they got sections of their city and Long Island wiped out, they began looking at something called microgrids. Islanded ability, it's like a bicycle. You've got multiple wheels connecting to a frame or a spine or a transmission line. Each of the wheels can function independently, or they can function together in a frame. So for example, you might have Hilo, you might have Waimea, you might have Kailua Kona, you might have different sections of the island that could, in the event of storms or disturbances, break off and be independent. In that way, you might say that the future is instead of stringing long transmission lines to isolated communities, you might say that Hawaii would form its own co-op, which may or may not be connected to the rest of the island. Kona could form its co-op that may be sometimes connected or not connected. The grid is going to be radically different than we envision it. I mean, 20 years ago, we all had landlines. Can you imagine if a landline company said to you, cell phones are great, but you all have to stay connected to the landline. You cannot give up your landline. You have to keep it no matter what. Now our cell phones are games, they're storage, their internet connectors, and occasionally their phones. We need to begin thinking about energy in vastly different ways. And one thing we do know, the future of energy is going to be radically different than any of us can think about right now. And we have to be open to that.
When you speak about that, and the fact is, the telecommunications business has changed, the electric business is changing, and if the grid changes, if with battery storage being available and generation changing, Jay Ignacio, how are the electric utilities looking at this? Are they adapting to the potential of a new model, or is the electric utility model of the centralized grid the model that would be used in the future, in your mind?
I think we need to be open to all, potential options. We need to look at different options. When you talk about the ideal, the ideal would be absolute clean energy, right? We give people choice so that they can self-generate if they want to, don't self-generate if they don't want to, do different tariffs for time of use, give them optionality, and then provide the low cost and the reliable service. Those are the things we're shooting for. That would be the ideal. We need to change with the times, I think, as a utility. We need to be open and see. falling behind the curve in interconnecting photovoltaics. I think we're learning from that. I don't think we're absolute failures with respect to not foreseeing that, because it caught everybody by surprise. I think even the photovoltaic developers were surprised by this. So we need to be open. I mean, we talk about microgrids. I think a microgrid may make sense in certain situations. We have, you know, the area of Pune where the transmission ties going into Pune was being threatened by a lava flow. So we actually relocated some of our smaller generators, put it in the Pune district, connected it up, tested it, in case the lava had disconnected and isolated that part of our grid, then we were being prepared to create a microgrid. I think North Kohala, I just was in North Kohala last weekend. You know, I think that might be an option, because we have plans. There's only one transmission feeding the community of North Kohala. And that transmission line is old, and we're going through plans of rebuilding, and we're looking at rerouting. But maybe a generator out in North Kohala, instead of a line rebuild, maybe we don't make the line as reliable, but if we have a problem and that line is disconnected and that community is isolated, then maybe we could do some kind of backup. We already have a wind farm in there that could serve the community. You know, we just an informal discussion with a few members of the community is, you know, I said, well, what's the idea? Would you like a diesel generator using biodiesel? And, you know, it's absolutely no, and we don't like that. But they are open to things like pump storage hydro. And now, if we wanted to do a transmission line, we're required by the Public Utilities Commission to do alternatives to transmission. We have to do as part of our evaluation what alternatives to transmission. So we have to be open. You know, we have to be open to these ideas. And I think, now we're talking about the merger, I think we have more opportunities partnering with a company like NextEra. I think we have more resources. They have grand scale. They have much more employees than we do. They can take a group of employees and focus on particular technological challenges. We don't have that luxury. We may be perceived big in the state. We're a very small utility. We don't have a lot of excess resources. You know, we have great people, though. You know, I commend our engineers for what they do. I mean, for the solutions they come up with in order to interconnect the amount of distributed generation that nobody else is dealing with, and our engineers are figuring it out, and all of the variable generation on our system, I think is remarkable. They're doing a good job. Partnering, but they're stretched thin. They can do only so much. I think partnering with an entity like NextEra, we can take it to the next level.
Some of the larger utilities across the country are building solar farms, and they're doing it on their own, and that would give ratepayers, well, that would give users the opportunity to benefit from cleaner technology without having to put solar on their own roof. Is that something that Hawaiian Electric is considering? Is that something that the co-op would consider? Marco, you're a solar guy. Why don't you address that first? Don't want you to fall asleep over there.
I think the way I address that, Sherry, is that questions such as how do we get to where we want to go as far as more renewables, cheaper renewables, specifically here on the Big Island, ultimately that decision would be made in a co-op, under a co-op model, by the co-op members. And the co-op members would be the 84 some odd thousand people who pay an electric bill month in, month out. And that's, I think, one of the real benefits and one of the really attractive possibilities and merits of a co-op model is that you've got the actual, the customers are the owners. So as Jay was mentioning, you've got kind of a challenge between, or the balancing between customers and owners, an investor-owned utility. Well, in a co-op model, the owners and the customers are one and the same. and I think that has a certain amount of appeal. So in terms of where's the mix, what's the best mix, that would be a decision made by the members of the co-op, whether it's more geothermal in Puna, whether it's geothermal on the west side, along the saddle, on the slopes of Hualalai. These are all questions, fantastic questions, critical questions that none of the members of the co-op as it is now has the authority or the knowledge to comment on. So it would be up to the members of the co-op to decide what that best energy mix would be.
Jay?
Before I answer the question, I must humbly apologize to Mark. He had mentioned earlier about KIUC crews coming, and it just came to my mind when I was talking to employees. Yes, they were here. I missed it. You're right, Mark. But we did have crews from KIUC, and I remember this because a former employee of ours had relocated to Kauai, and I remember after the event was over having, you know, a discussion with him about this. I'm really sorry, Mark, but I misspoke on that. Now, what was the question?
Well, I'm not going to tell you exactly. Solar farms, and try to be brief because we're almost out of time and I have a couple more questions.
Solar farms is an option, you know, that we consider. I talked about it. Going forward, we may consider solar farms or wind as an alternative. We put that in our power supply improvement plan. But you can't just do it alone. We've reached a level where you just can't put in another additional wind farm. It has to be combined with another technology because you need to combine it with another technology so that it can displace an existing, what we call conventional generating unit. You can no longer just keep adding variable generation on like we've been doing up to this point. Going forward, you're going to have to combine technologies if you want to retire some of the conventional units that are fueled by fossil fuels. One of our strategies is instead of doing that combination is go to technologies that already have it inherently, and that's biomass and new generation of geothermal energy. That's why we're looking at that.
Did you want to say something, Henry? You looked passive like you were going to.
Well, there was a distributed generation docket a number of years ago before the Public Utilities Commission, and it was decided by the Public Utilities Commission that if HECO were able to bid against an independent power producer, and then HECO was the one looking at the two bids, and then HECO was the one that selected the winning bid, it were more likely that it would be a utility-run one. And therefore, the PUC said that for distributed generation, the utility could not own it. Now, there has been a slight recent modification or wrinkle with that, with a proposed solar farm, where the question is, who can own it, who can build it, who can operate it, that kind of thing. But that is an issue that the commission is going to have to wrestle with, especially if NextEra takes over. Because NextEra will have a utility in one camp and a sister company that is a developer. So, for example, the sister company is currently working with Parker Ranch to look at developing their wind resources. And another sister company is looking at a site on Maui for a wind farm. So if you have different sister companies that are technically independent, can one have a contract with the other one? So that will all have to be worked out before the PUC.
Should there be any concern over the fact that some of the Hawaiian Electric executives will get very large sums of money if the NextEra purchase is approved? Several millions?
Well, you might consider the fact that the CEO of AGI makes $5 million a year, but will get $12 million if the deal goes through. On the other hand, the CEO of NextEra makes $10 million. So clearly, the upper leadership of NextEra and AGI are very different than the rest of us.
when I describe...
That's where you need to go to get that check. Okay? When
I describe what is going to happen is Hawaiian Electric Industries, which is a holding company, and then you have Hawaiian Electric, which serves Oahu, and then you have Hawaii Electric Light Company, Maui Electric, and then you have the bank. The change of control of the merger, what it involves is you essentially are going to eliminate that Hawaiian Electric Industries component. So whoever is working for Hawaiian Electric Industries and the CEO, they're no longer going to have jobs. They're not going to be part of the new entity. So part of the change of control, so that you know everyone has the right interest, is that compensation. That's what's happening here. Because going forward, there are no Hawaiian Electric Industry jobs. All of those jobs will be eliminated.
We have more questions, but we have no more time. I want to remind you of one thing, which is you have feedback forms on your chair, colored pieces of paper they'd like you to fill out. And I believe Bill Buckby from the group wanted to make final comments. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you so much to our presenters. Before we say, let Bill talk, let's give them a warm round of applause.
Two quick announcements. First of all, we're going to continue this series and conclude it on September 17th, after we take our summer break. Whether your next car is going to plug in and you're going to power from the rooftop, whether your next truck is going to be hydrogen fuel, whether you're going to be your own utility, all these options are going to be explored in September by the stakeholders here on the island that are leading the technology and in the growth of our own energy options as consumers. The other announcement is I want to talk about something very new for community enterprises. We are the organization that sponsored the West Hawaii Forum activity. Something really exciting. In the time that we first did the website several years ago, not much has changed. We are launching a brand new website tonight with a new domain that is an address. It's called westhawaiiforum.org. What's special about this is it's a part of bringing the organization better out to you and into the 21st century. The new website will do a lot of things. First and foremost, to be able to post questions online for our future presenters before the event, actually occurs. If you are unable to actually be here, and this is a part of our organization's outreach to all of West Hawaii, not just the Kona community, you'll be able to see the event not only on cable, but after, posted on our website in the archive section. These are just two of a number of features that are going to be available to you. I encourage all of you to go to westhawaiiforum.org and take a look. We welcome your input. We are here for you, and we do a better job when you participate in not only these meetings, but also in these new tools that we made available on the website. Thank you all for coming tonight.
We also want to thank Chuck Connors for helping us with AV and sound. Thank you so much.